Yes, thank you very much for your introduction. Thank you very much, Shane and Davide, for having me here. Voilà. And I hope you're all able to see my screen. Yes. Okay, so, well, but it's not in the right place. Now it's like that, sorry. Okay, so one of the achievements of research in dramatic performances in the last 20 years is that it has succeeded in breaking free of its Athenocentric features and of its concentration on the fifth century, almost with a vengeance. And I'm here thinking of Mirko yesterday. There are at least as many books on tragedy abroad as there are about Athenian performances, almost. More and more publications focus on agones and festivals outside Athens and on tracing continuities and discontinuities from the fifth century to later periods. The publication in 2020 of the second volume of Eric Sapo and Peter Wilson's A Social and Economic History of the Theatre to 300 BC, Theatre Beyond Athens, is a result of this change. 939 pages dedicated to theater in the Attic teams and the rest of the Greek world outside Athens from the beginnings down to 300. And yet, many questions concerning the diffusion of drama throughout the Greek world remain open. Also, beyond the specialist works, a persistently simplifying narrative remains in place. The story, in its general lines, opens by acknowledging that musical performances since the earliest times were ubiquitous in the ancient Greek world. We can trace different types of performances in different areas at the same time, and actually before the emergence of the Attic Dionysia. There was indeed, as John Harrington put it, a rich song and dance culture out of which Athenian tragedy emerged. Then, at some point under the Pisistratids, we hear of performances in honor of Dionysus in Attica, performances which involve drama with shadowy names such as Caesarion and Thespis, and shortly after the institutional reform of Clisthenes, around 508, we hear of a complete reorganization of the festival of the city Dionysia. From now on, the Dionysia will comprise competitions of choral dances by the tribes, what we tend to call dithyrambic choruses, as well as whole city tragic competitions. The next clearly traceable step is the introduction of comic contests in 486 BCE. Meanwhile, other festivals are set up, the Lenae, the rural Dionysia, and so the story goes, drama spreads, helped along by the growing influence of Athens, for the city by this time has acquired leadership of the Delian League and controls not just the Aegean, but also the cities of the coast of Asia Minor. The city Dionysia takes place at a moment when navigation restarts. They are attended by allied members of the League who are required to bring the tribute at this moment, which means that they participate directly in the ritual celebrations. They're also attended by travelers, and so then drama spreads. Tragedy in particular reaches Sicily early under the Daenomenids. It reaches Macedon, at any rate by the end of the fifth century, as exemplified by Euripides' Archelaus. And in the course of the fourth century at the latest, it spreads everywhere like wildfire, until by the third century there is not a place, not just around the Mediterranean, but also in the Greek inhabited interior, that does not have a theater, visited periodically by actors or troops, the Dionysakoi Technitai. And so when we find Dionysia festivals with theatrical performances in so many places of the ancient Greek world, the assumption that there must have been an Athenian influence and that the diffusion of tragedy and more generally of the Dionysia is an Athenian legacy is inescapable. But to simply talk of influence and legacy is not sufficient. We need to ask what the legacy exactly was. That is, we need to ask what cultural products and institutions exactly were adopted. The festival as a complex and regulated institutional frame, starting with the god to whom it was dedicated, continuing through with the financing, with the various ceremonies, and with choral dancing, tragic plays, comic plays in competition, or simply elements of it. And if the latter, then we have to ask which elements and would they be felt as recognizably Athenian. We should also wonder about how conscious an adoption this may have been and about the direction of the exchange. Was the Panhellenic diffusion of tragedy something more or less given an impulse from Athens itself, or was it the other way around, a process of appropriation? In short, we must ask about agency. And we need to ask when exactly this happened. In the 5th century, when Athens held sway throughout the Aegean and Aeschylus, Sophocles, and Euripides were producing their plays at the Dionysia, or in the 4th century, when the reperformance of their texts eventually led at the time of Lycurgus to their canonization? Or should we think on an even later moment through Alexander the Great and through the action of the Dionysiakoi Technitai? Asking the question when is also important for another reason. The organization of the Dionysia changed, of the Athenian Dionysia. The festival underwent a long history of adjustments and additions about which we are reasonably well informed thanks to the epigraphic documentation. The most important changes from our point of view here possibly are the introduction of a competition for tragic actors at the Dionysia sometime between 451 and 448, and for tragic and comic actors at the Lenaea at some point around 430 BCE, because this obviously helped the move towards professionalization. Then the introduction of reperformances of old plays at the Dionysia as non-competitive events in 487-6 BCE, and certainly as a regular part of the festival from a point before 342. The addition in 340 of an old comedy as well, and finally the move from choregia to agonothesia, following which the demos became the choregos. These were all changes that in different ways profoundly modified the festival. And so when we look at the Hellenistic period, beyond the apparent similarity of Dionysia festivals in so many places of the ancient world, we must query what we see and we must ask what exactly is the Athenian model between inverted comma that is being transmitted. Are there, for instance, any democratic overtones? Finally, we need to bear in mind the possibility, very real, of mediated transfers. Once the associations of the technitai, the actors of Dionysus, began to be central to the organization of dramatic festivals, they would shape structures and performances. They would be in the limelight. How much might an Athenian background be felt in these conditions? So in what follows, I will first look at the diffusion of tragedy, leaving aside comedy and choral dancing. The reason for the exclusion of comedy is that its diffusion, in particular for what concerns new comedy, has been discussed in a recent paper by David Constan, already mentioned yesterday by Nino Luraghi. David Constan's whose conclusions, namely that new comedy helped spread and promote throughout the Hellenistic world an idealized generic Athenian ideal, I find convincing. As for choral dances, they were ubiquitous in the Greek world. They appear in so many diverse contexts that unless competitive choral tribal dancing appears in the specific context of a festival called Dionysia, there is simply no point in thinking about Athenian influence. So my first step will be the diffusion of tragedy in the 5th century and in the following period. Next, I want to look at the diffusion of the festival of the Dionysia as a whole, looking for patterns. Here, potential Athenian agency will have to be discussed, as well as alternative or parallel possibilities. And I will look in this context at a couple of specific examples. But before we begin, I must mention some of the problems besetting such an inquiry. First, we have extremely little of tragedy after the 5th century. Unlike comedy, where we have at least some of the plays of Menander, for tragedy, we must base any evaluation of its form and content on bare titles and meager fragments, with two exceptions, which turn out to be rather exceptional themselves, the Exagoge of Exekiel and Lycophron's Alexandra. Needless to say, this has led to quite divergent evaluations as to the degree of politicization of the new tragedies. And I leave this on the side. The little that can be safely said of tragedy and tragic performances in the fourth and third century BCE boils down to the following point. First, the importance of the medial revolution, which came with the diffusion of writing and books. Tragedy, old and new, became accessible also through writing, as the very numerous papyri attest, and so Athenian fifth and fourth century tragedy did continue to exercise an influence in that form as well, also on the new plays being produced. Second, the possibility opened up of performances of highlights, bravura pieces, parts of tragedies, requiring less economic investment. And third, what fragments of new tragedies we have show an almost complete avoidance of resolution and actic corruption in the iambic trimeter. This is visible in the fragments of the authors of the Pleiad and notably in Lycophron's Alexandra. Such a tendency goes in the opposite direction of what had been visible in the plays of the late Euripides, where the iambic trimeter had become closer and closer to everyday speech. But as Fantuzzi and Hunter point out, the reason for the later tragedians' strict metrical practice is probably not to be seen so much in the desire to mark a difference from Attic tragedy, as rather in the attempt to separate tragedy as much as possible from everyday speech and comedy, that is to mark it as literarily tragic. Another major difficulty is the fact that some of the evidence is of limited use when looking at details. I refer to the diffusion of the theaters as physical buildings. Maps giving the location of theaters in the ancient world are by now legion. Indeed, the diffusion of the theater as a building does say quite a lot concerning the great convergence. The theater is now one of the urban features that mark a city as such. But as the debate, for instance, about the date of Sicilian theaters shows, exact dates are difficult to obtain. More importantly, the existence of a stone theater does not tell much about what exactly happened in these theaters, what was performed in the context of which festival, for which gods, at the expenses and with the support of whom. Nor, in the absence of a stone theater, can we exclude the possibility of a wooden structure. Finally, inscriptions give us a point in time, the moment when a festival exists, but rarely its inception and rarely its demise, which is why any discussion of the diffusion of tragedy and the Dionysia has to put together rather disparate sets of evidence to reach results that are ultimately always provisional. So let me begin with the early diffusion of tragedy in the fifth century and how we might imagine it. The examples which are typically discussed concern Greek Sicily and Macedon. We simply do not know enough about the rest of the Greek world. In Sicily, there was a local production of comedy already by the end of the sixth century. There is also some evidence in a fragment in Cercei Fabulae of Epicharmus of judges at festivals in Sicily, which implies a competitive context. A much discussed early Lede Defixio, possibly from Gela, in which a certain Apelles pray for Eunikos to win and curses numerous other choragoi, is in support of this idea. Now, the fact that there was a solidly rooted local performance tradition may explain the speed with which the Sicilian tyrants made use of the potential offered by tragedy. There is no reason to doubt that Aeschylus traveled to Sicily on the invitation of Hieron, for whom, possibly in 471 BCE, he produced his Aetnaean Women, celebrating the new foundation of Aetna in 476. His Persians were also performed in Sicily, if one can trust the life of Aeschylus, evidently as part and parcel of the attempt to equate the victories of Himera and Cumae with those against the Persians. And finally, at some point after 450 BCE, Aeschylus traveled one last time to Sicily, where he died and was buried in Gela. According to the Vita, those who make their living with tragedy frequented his tomb, which became the site of ritual celebrations and performances. So here we seem to have a direct straight connection. Indeed, for Barbara Kowalczyk, Athenian drama's diffusion abroad is intrinsically linked to the Syracusan scene and the figure of Aeschylus. At the same time, what is being exported here? Not the Dionysia as a festival, not the structure, not the competitions. Aeschylus was invited exactly as the tyrants had invited Pindar and Bacchylides. Aeschylus's Ethnaia was not designed for a competitive contest. And as far as we can see, the context in which Sicily is performed in Sicily are not linked to Dionysus, but rather to Demeter or possibly Apollo Temenites. We see here how flexible an instrument tragedy could be. The Daenomenic tyrants could without difficulty use it for their own purposes. Indeed, tragedy qua single play or group of plays could travel easily and did. Some other relatively early cases of performances or reperformances abroad are known, possibly in Thessaly, Euripides Andromache, and certainly by the end of the 5th century in Macedon. So, without going further in here, why did tragedy catch so well in contexts that were so very different from the Athenian one and from each other as Sicily and Argead Macedon? Was this a diffusion by design, my other question? Now, the Dionysia, and in particular the tragic performances of the Dionysia, were no doubt designed to showcase Athenian cultural hegemony. I think this is beyond discussion. But interpreting the references in tragedy to places all over the ancient Mediterranean as attempts to create imperial links between these places and Athens, or as meant to prepare the ground for future reperformances, are, I feel, excessive and do not make sense of all contexts. A softer version, however, accounts well for the take of tragedy. Tragedy was Panhellenic in the sense that it was about connections, about links between Athens and the rest of the world. The myths adapted by the tragedians concerned a multitude of Greeks and non-Greek communities, East and West, and the travels of the heroes explain the connections between these areas. So the table from Stuart's recent book, which you have here on the handout, gives a good sense of the ground covered by tragic myth and of how it addressed concerns and places that went well beyond Athens. Edmund Stuart has also recently made a strong case for an early diffusion of tragedy through pre-existing networks of festivals and patrons along which tragic poets traveled. Indeed, traveling poets and actors will have played a role not only at the end of the 5th and in the 4th century, as is commonly accepted, but also in the earlier period. Nonetheless, the fact remains that Athens does have a special position in all this. No other city managed to set up a theatrical spectacle rivaling Athens. Syracuse might have had the means, but clearly at that point it was not interested in doing so. What made the difference between the Athenian experience of tragedy and elsewhere was the context. It was the festival of the Dionysia with its yearly frame. So as pointed out by Skudel, to understand the diffusion of tragic performance, we need to consider how tragedy affected the Greeks outside its institutional context, and this means outside its Athenian institutional context. With the end of the 5th century, our main sources, the text of the tragic plays themselves, end. That certainly does not mean that tragic production ended. What happened in the 4th century is a double process. On the one hand, reperformances of older plays became common, and the three great Athenian tragedians became part of the standard repertoire of theaters across Greece, with a copy of their plays being preserved in the State Archive of Athens in a process that has been discussed by Johanna Hanning. And you have on the handout references to reperformances both at Athens and outside in Tegea in a list of a tragic actor victories. But on the other hand, if 5th century tragedy occupied a central place in Lycurgus's agenda, During the following centuries, a number of new original plays were written and performed alongside the classical ones. In fact, the formation of a repertoire of classical plays brought about not the death of Attic tragedy, but rather its globalization, a point made by Patricia Easterling, with the result that overall requests continued to be high also for new plays. Snell and Kanicht, in volume one of the Tragicorum Graecorum Fragmenta, dedicated to the Didascalie and to the minor tragic poets, list 49 authors for a long fifth century, 44 authors for the fourth century, 33 for the third, 25 for the second, and 30 for the first century BCE. Now, numbers do not tell a story, not even half of it. Some of these authors had a rich and important production, as Didamas, for instance. Others are but names or were active in more than one genre. Nonetheless, this gives a sense of the scale at which production of tragedy continued. The other interesting aspect is the provenance of playwrights. If already in the fifth century some poets were non-Athenians who came to Athens to compete, the trend continues and intensifies as we go down in time. And I have put some example on the handout, but I won't go there. So we have looked at Athens and its possible role in the fifth and fourth centuries, the very clear interest of the city in enshrining its theatrical capital in the second half of the fourth century has often been remarked upon. And Lambert, for instance, has discussed a series of decrees of this period that all have to do with enhancing the status of the theater. But is this sufficient to assume a model in which drama, the Dionysia, would have spread directly from Athens? So far, we have looked at tragedy. What about the festival? So here under point six, I have listed all places where Dionysia are attested, except the Attic themes, from the earliest moment down to about 250. This gives us a sense of the spread of the Dionysia in the fifth and fourth century, if we accept that the first attestation always only means already existing. I want to look at the distribution of these instances of early Dionysia to gauge the potential role Athens may have played, either through direct influence or as an inspiration. I start with the West, and rather surprisingly, notwithstanding the very numerous theaters in Sicily, there are no epigraphic attestation of a festival Dionysia, with the exception of Taras, which had Dionysia at the latest by 282 BCE, and probably much earlier, if the rich production of theatrical vases can be interpreted in that sense. Corinth, Sicyon, and Epidauros all have Dionysia too, but it is difficult to say much about how they were organized. The Arcadian group is interesting. At Tegea, a dedication on a theater bench dated to the second half of the fourth century, seg 11,070, reads Cymbalos dedicated to Dionysios Agonotetesas, that is having served as Agonotetes. There were presumably Dionysia at Tegea, a much later agonistic catalog of a tragic actor, the one I mentioned earlier, proclaims that that actor won overall in 88 Scenic Agones, Dionysia and other festival which the cities conduct. It's just an inference, of course. But at Orchomenos, we find a similar dedication, also dated to the fourth century BC, also on a bench of the theater, son of Epigenes to Dionysos, having served as Agonothetes. At Megalopolis, around 330, the Agonothetes inscribed his dedication on three of the nine prohedic benches, on the first, the fifth, and the ninth. It was Antiochus, having served as Agonothetes, dedicated all the thrones and the Dreios, simply dedicated. And a second century Agonothetic dedication, also from Megalopolis, with to Dionysus and the city, shows that this theater was linked to Dionysus. Finally, for Figaleadador, Siculus reports how in 374 or maybe 371-70, the oligarchs massacred many of the citizens of Figaleia who were sitting in the theater at the Dionysia. Here too, a second or first temple inscription near the site of the temple of Dionysus indicates that there were Dionysia, although this was not, at least by then, an annual event. If the city celebrates the Dionysia in the year in which the Andrineia takes place, let it take place by a three-year interval. Now, this is rather scattered and flimsy evidence, and we do not even know what kind of performances went on in these theaters. Nonetheless, the presence in the region of theaters all datable to the same period, as well as the presence of agonothetai, and the fact that in two, possibly three places there is a festival Dionysia is interesting. As Xapo and Wilson suggest, the theaters and their organization might have all been set up in the period of democratic unification as a common and potentially democratic gesture with an anti-Spartan character. There might be here an Athenian model at work, although not the agonothesia, and I'll come back to that. At the same time, this is also very much a case of local networking, of horizontal spread. Another group that's interesting, but for different reasons, oh, sorry, can that move? Yes. Different reason is that formed by the Cyclades and by the cities of the coast of Asia Minor. By far the highest number of places which had Dionysia by 300 BCE or slightly later had been part of the 5th century Delian League and or also of the 2nd Athenian League. Some of them, like Lemnos or Samnos, had been clerocies. This is a situation in which an Athenian influence seems on the whole evident, notwithstanding differences, some small, some rather significant, within the group. I want to focus here first on Delos, which has already been mentioned quite a lot yesterday. Delos is a striking case of Athenian influence in reverse, at least for what concerns theater and the Dionysia. For while we find many Dionysia festivals throughout the area controlled in the 5th century by Athens, there was no theater in Delos until the very end of the 4th century, that is, until the island became independent. And there were no Dionysia. Delos was where the Athenians and their allies would send choruses. But there was, as I said, no Dionysia and no theater. It is in the accounts of the Hieropoioi of 308-6 that the first reference to a theater appears. And the tabulae archontum for the year 284 give details on the organization of the Dionysia, which at this point comprised two lyric choruses, two comedies, and two tragedies. Although dramatic performances are only then attested from 284 BCE, there is sufficient other evidence, dedications and such like, to bring them back to about 304 and to make it quite likely that this began very soon after the independence. Also, another important point noted by Xapo and Wilson 2020, this Dionysia follow very closely the Athenian model. So, how to explain their institution paradoxically at the moment when the Athenians left? It is very tempting to assume that there were no Dionysia on Delos because Athens did not want a rival Dionysia in an important religious center so close home. This is a point that had been made more generally by Ruth Scodell in another paper. But if that is so, then rather than export, we should maybe think of an attempt at control by Athens and of irresistible spread through the interest of the others. The setting up of Dionysia by the Delians so soon after their independence and on a model and at dates so close to the Athenian ones would then signify their acknowledgement of the potential of the Dionysia as a festival and at the same time a markedly anti-Athenian gesture. Likewise, all the other small differences that one finds in the way that the Dionysia are set up locally may have something to do with the desire of participating in this great thing, but also of exhibiting a degree of local differentiation. Now, I do not have the time to look in detail at all of these places. Kos and Rhodes in particular would be rewarding. At Kos, a theater is first mentioned in an inscription of about 295 to 80 BC, in which it is stipulated that if there are any remaining funds, they should be spent on the theater. Then a fragmentary honorific decree of the same period shows that there was an agon of the Dionysia at which honors were to be announced. More specific is another proxeny decree, which specified that the honors have to be proclaimed at a choral agon. This implies that theater and theatrical performances at which honors were announced go back sometime into the fourth century because of the early date, and possibly relatively shortly after the Cynicism. And again, this might, if we are willing to go that way, might set up a very interesting parallel with Rhodes. Anyway, we have to wait in Kos until about 206-5 to know exactly what kind of performances were going on in Kos, and what we see is rather different from the Athenian model. I pass on the detail, but one interesting aspect is that the proclamation of honors was at the choral contests. There may have been an economic reason for that. We see, if you look closely at the text, that some years there was no tragedy and some years no comedy, but there was always a cyclic agon, a choral context, possibly because it was cheaper. But it seems to me that one can also delineate a trend away from announcement at tragic contests towards announcement at choral contests, in which the chorus would be locally composed, or even announcement at other festivals, which were felt as more relevant. This is an issue I've already discussed, but it would be, so I will not rediscuss, but it would be a good example of the taking over of an institutional practice and of its further adjustment to local requirements. Eventually, to quote John Ma, we may wonder whether when Hellenistic citizens listened to the proclamation of honors at the Dionysia in their theaters, they thought about how the genealogy of such practices included classical Athenian innovations. I think that in the case of honorific decrees, given the frequent addition that the decrees should be sent to the city of the honorand so that a proclamation be made there as well, what may have been foremost in the minds of the citizen when listening to the announcement, if they listened at all, was the fact that they were doing this just as well, or maybe better or worse than their neighbors, where neighbors does not necessarily imply geographical proximity, but rather closeness of exchanges. Mention of the probable economic difficulties of the Koans offers a reason to look into the funding for the festival. As is well known, at Athens, the expense for the Dionysia were jointly covered by the city and elite individuals, in the sense that elite private citizens, the choregoi, sponsored choruses, and the city paid for the poets and offered the prizes. And then the system changed to the agonothesia, the deity still disputed. When we move elsewhere, as you saw in Arcadia, agonothesia was present probably earlier. So here we might have a case where Athens comes after. It is also interesting, sorry, I cut a bit, but fundamentally, Iasos and Corcyra here in the handout point to two very different, much later, we are in the second century BC, so a much later system of funding the agones in Iasos through a